It's the top five tutors.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Welcome back to Commander Countdown, the show where we ask hard-hitting questions of the Commander community and bring the answers to you. Now, are you the type of Commander player who says they love having an inconsistent singleton format because the games are different every time, but what you actually want is your deck to do the busted thing every time and have your opponents be too inconsistent to stop you? If that sounds like you, then this is the episode for you. We have the top five tutors in Commander. Tutors, as we're defining it, are just things where you go into your deck, find a particular card, and move it to another zone. Veggie, what's your honorable mention for tutors?
I like a lot of bad tutors.
Me too. That movie was great.
Bad tutors. I like a lot of bad movies. I think if I'm going to give like an honest, good tutor that did not make this list, I'm going to say War of Invention. This is an X and 3 blue instant with improvise, so you can tap your artifacts to help pay for colorless mana for it. You search for an artifact card with cost X or less and put it directly onto the battlefield.
It's pretty cool that this is an instant, so you can actually flash it in on your opponent's turn. I'm just imagining flashing in, like, Parhelion 2 or something out of the deck, because you have the artifacts to cast it, probably.
Yes.
And then you can crew it and block with a 5-5 Vigilance First Strike.
Right. Yeah. Honestly, this is usually finding, like, Krark's Thumb.
Darksteel Citadel, probably, realistically what we're getting, yeah.
Or like, I don't know, like a Panharmonicon at the end of your, like, right before you untap is pretty good. This is just like the instant speed to board is very relevant. And the fact that this is usually costing you just 3 mana is great.
My honorable mention is Archdruid's Charm. And I've been playing a lot of this card in Pioneer and I've been super impressed with it. It's 3 green for an instant spell that says you can either tutor a creature card to your hand, tutor a land card onto the battlefield, put a +1/+1 counter on a creature you control and have it fight something that the opponent controls, or exile target artifact or enchantment. And all of this happens at instant speed. I love the flexibility of this card, because if you have all the land that you need in your lands deck, then you can find the payoff at your opponent's end step. If you don't have the lands that you need, or you're looking for a specific land like Lotus Field, you can put it into play on the opponent's end step before they even know it's coming. And if the opponent has like a hate piece or an enchantment or artifact that is knocking you out, then you can exile that on their end step and go off on your turn. I think this kind of flexibility is really good, and the cost of 3 green, if you're doing a land-based synergy ramp deck, is probably a cost that you're already able to pay.
It's too much green.
It's a lot of green. It is a lot of green.
that's a lot of things that this can do. Because like that's typically one of the biggest problems with tutors is they don't do the thing right away. Here's pay some mana to get a thing that you then have to pay some mana for. And this is just like, oh, it might just be the answer to the problem that you're having.
And telegraph to the world that you have found the thing. Everyone look at me, I'm about to do the thing, and it loses some of its bite.
Speaking of bite, that second mode is pretty good.
It's not bad. I usually don't use it, but I have used it on like an Arboreal Grazer to fight X1s on the opponent's board, so it comes up more often than you think.
Targets in Commander, like this finds Field of the Dead.
Yeah.
This hits Rhystic Study and Smothering Tithe and, you know, can find your Crater Hoof. That's so much for green.
It's the kind of effect that also gets better as they print more and more cards, because eventually they're going to print a busted artifact or a busted enchantment, that they're only getting better. And this will scale to deal with that.
This hits the One Ring.
It does hit the One Ring.
This deals with the One Ring. Oh man,
they keep printing more and more busted artifacts and cards tip you off? Yeah, okay.
what we're saying here is, wow, the things that it does that's not tutor are really good.
Yep.
You voted for number 5 best tutor in Magic for Commander. Scheming Symmetry. Big thumbs up to this card. 1 black sorcery. Choose 2 target players. Each of them searches their library for a card, shuffles the library, and puts it on top.
You said thumbs up for this card, and now I'm looking at the art, and I can't help but think of this Bizarro World Siskel and Ebert, where they're grading movies with the thumbs up and thumbs down, but it's actually just their demonic faces up or down. Wouldn't have done as well, I don't think. I love this card. I think that the politics aspect to it is great. I run it in Blim. Part of the problem with the tutors that we already talked about is that you know the table knows that you got the thing that you wanted, but now someone else did too, and it might take some of the heat off of you until your turn when you get to actually play that card.
Right. And like, there's so many different angles that you can approach this at. Like, there is just simply the politics angle of like, hey, but that person got a thing too. Or like, hey, I'm just playing mono red. I don't have an answer to that enchantment that is going to kill us. So I need you, control player, to find your answer. Or like, oh, you put a thing on top of your library? Great. Now I'm going to use my thing that steals the top card of your library.
Oh, that's even meaner than what I was going to suggest. I was going to say you're running a mill deck.
Yeah.
And you put it on top and now all of a sudden it's gone. So you had a one mana tutor and you were already going to mill them.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. In something like that, it's just another copy of X tutor that is probably later on this list. Honestly, this is my ideal tutor for Commander as a whole. It's interactive. You're doing things that are powerful, but also changing the dynamic of the game. You know, yes, you are adding some consistency to your deck, but in a way that you are also presenting your own problem for yourself. Like, and the different ways that you can approach this, I think is very fun if you're going to be running cheap tutors in the deck.
All right, and time for number four, and the community has done it again. They've put a card that is not legal on the list. Number four is the silver-bordered Booster Tutor. For one black instant, open a sealed Magic Booster Pack, reveal the cards, and put one of them into your hand. Remove that card from your deck before beginning a new game. Thank you, Booster Tutor. this effect can be pretty fun. I remember playing against Daniel Holt's Champions of the Realm card, the Kamigawa Planeswalker that minuses to tutor from a Kamigawa booster specifically, and that added a lot of flavor. I feel like this is a little too general, a little too random, but maybe that's what you're really looking for out of your tutor, a random experience.
If I'm playing in a Commander game where we're cool with silver border cards, one, I'm very happy, and two, this is exactly what I want to do. Like, I like that randomness. Like, hey, all right, I got my big old bag of boosters. I'm just gonna grab one. Oh, great, I got homelands. Let's see what Homerid I pull out of this. Like, this is very fun, and of course, you know that there's. It's very obvious why it would be banned, but in the games where everybody's agreed that you can play this, perfect.
You know what I want to do with this card? I want to storm it up, make 150 copies of it, get 150 more cards into my library, and win with Battle of Wits.
Oh! Oh!
Yeah!
Everybody's too distracted by Claire de Lune Battle of Wits. They never realized Booster Tutor Battle of Wits was already on the table.
Yeah, and you get to, you know, pay $700 for the booster packs to pull it off.
Yeah.
I think the packs that you would bring with you would probably have to be like box toppers, right? Like, you can get those pretty cheaply. There's one card in them, but you don't care what it is. It's just the piece of cardboard is what matters.
Right. And in the official Gatherer notes for this unset card, you know, so very important, it does say that you can use any sealed Magic booster pack. So yeah, like box toppers, promo packs, things like that, that's legal for Booster Tutor.
You could search for it. You could even pull out a Commander Precon.
I don't know about that, because it does say booster pack.
Okay.
Stop trying to break Booster Tutor.
Yeah, chat, what do you think? Are we counting Commander Precons as promo packs for the purpose of Booster Tutor? Let us know in the comments.
The other note does say you can open booster packs that contain cards that are not legal in the format you're playing, but I don't know what boosters are not legal in Commander.
Well, it's not that the boosters aren't legal, it's that the cards they contain are not legal. So if you find, Alpha or something, and you pull, you know, something from there that's banned in Commander, or whatever set Hull Breacher is from, or something like that, you could get it into the game that way.
So with Booster Tutor, you could open something that's like, here's an anti card, and then play that and steal your opponent's cards permanently. That's there. We go.
Yep.
Booster Tutor is the best tutor because you gain your opponent's cards permanently.
Perfect.
Let's get away from all of that. Number three on the list of best tutors for Commander, Beseech the Mirror. This is 1 and 3 black sorcery with bargain. You can sacrifice an artifact, enchantment, or token as you cast. You search for a card, exile face down, and then shuffle. If it was bargained, then you cast the spell for free if it costs 4 or less. But otherwise, you just put it in your hand.
Yeah, this is a kind of cool way to get around the tax effect that we were talking about earlier. The tutor doesn't cost you anything as long as you sacrifice something from the battlefield, and then you get the card you're tutoring for free.
Right. Yeah, you just it's for the low, low cost of like a blood token. You're just casting your spell, and 4. There's a lot of good stuff at 4.
Yeah, I mean, Shieldred is the first thing that comes to mind. Also, the One Ring again.
Yeah, what others? Plenty of board wipes.
Sure. It's also just a straight up tutor, right? Like if you're looking for a 7 CMC card, it does just go to your hand. It's not like you can't find those.
Right. It's a little pricey for that, but like, if it's the thing you need, then great.
Yeah, you can sacrifice your Arcane Signet to go find your Soul Ring. Great.
Although that is relevant too. Not that specifically, but like, as far as, you know, in your Commander games, you are almost always going to have something that you can bargain. You have your mana rocks.
Yep. And eventually, towards the end of the game, those aren't nearly as important as in the early game. So turn them into something better.
There are some neat tricks with this because it is casting the spell from exile. So you're triggering any of those things that care, like Passionate Archaeologist, or if you find your Delayed Blast Fireball, then that goes off for 5 damage instead of 2 because it sees that it's being cast from exile.
Coming in at number 2 is Vampiric Tutor. 1 black, instant, search for a card, put it on top, you lose 2. That's all there is to it.
Yeah.
Pretty powerful effect to have at instant, I think.
Yeah, we knew this was going to make it up there on the list. It's one of those. Yep, I don't know. 2 life is nothing for the cost of putting the exact answer that you need on top of your library right before you untap.
Yeah, especially for decks that don't just want the card. They want the card on top specifically. Like, I've played Yennet with this before, and one of the problems with that deck is you need to stack the library, then go to combat, and if Yennet dies, you don't get that card anymore. But what you can do with Yennet is you can attack with her, make sure you get the trigger, and then in response to the trigger, you can Vamp Tutor something onto the top.
Mm-hmm. Or Miracles.
Yeah.
Like, you can Vamp Tutor for your Temporal Mastery. Here's a Time Walk.
Yep.
Plus, with it only being 1 mana... it's so easy to have any other effect to be able to draw that card and have mana left to play it.
Yeah, the nice thing, like we said, about having these tutor effects at instant is that you can do it on your opponent's end step, so they don't have super advanced knowledge that it's coming, but it goes to the top as well. So in terms of power level, the opponents at least know something is coming before it happens.
Right. And that does give you a little window to interact with it. So like if an opponent does have a way to mill you.
They could Field of Ruin you?
Yes. They can make you shuffle in any number of ways, but that's like a pretty simple one. Land destruction. It does put you down a card.
It does, yeah. Card disadvantage. So you're trading quantity for quality here. But usually when you're the one deciding to make that choice, so usually it's going to come out in your favor.
Yeah, out of your 100 cards, probably the thing that you're grabbing is worth 2 cards.
Yeah.
Number 1, the best tutor in Magic for Commander, as voted on by you. We knew what was coming. It's Demonic Tutor. 1 and a black, a sorcery. Search your library for a card, put it in your hand. That's it.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of what the entire episode is named after, right? This is the tutor that began all tutors. It's why they're all called tutors since then.
Mm-hmm.
This is the original. It was from Alpha, right?
Yes.
And they definitely learned their lesson. Yeah, this is going to be an interesting card to get your guys' pulse on, because this is the best tutor. Just straight up, it is the best tutor. There's no downside. It costs 2 mana. It is sorcery speed, but you're going to be able to consistently get the best card in your deck with basically no downside.
Right.
And that means that it's going to function at a very high power level, but it's also going to be really consistent, and that causes some political issues both at and away from the table.
Democrats playing Demonic Tutor. It's named after him. So
that's what we mean, right?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
What's more warping of a game? Is it Demonic Tutor drawn at some point, or is it turn one Soul Ring? Because I think that if you don't like the power level of turn one Soul Ring and this is worse, then that's a pretty good comparison to make. Like, what turns things into more non-interactable non-games? Is it turn one Soul Ring, or is it Demonic Tutor? Because I think it's probably Demonic Tutor. I think turn one Soul Ring can be dealt with by three people pretty easily, but Demonic Tutor, you can find a very specific card that threads the needle of what your opponent's brought to the table.
That is a question. Okay. I think for me, it's turn one Soul Ring. Because, yes, three people can deal with it, but how often are they prepared to deal with it before it's a problem? And Demonic Tutor in itself is not the biggest problem. Like, if you're playing in a high power deck, then the other players have high power answers. If you're playing in a low power deck, then you have less good options for the situation that you're in. Like, it's still close, but to me, jumping ahead two turns for the entire game is more game warping.
I guess my question is, how many times have you left a commander game that you lost and thought, if this card in my hand had only been this other one, the table wasn't able to deal with that? Because in those cases, Tutor would have just found you the card you actually wanted and you would have won the game from there. So if that happens to you a lot, then I would say Tutor is more game swingy than Soul Ring is.
I don't know, because I think you're always going to be able to do that. With 100 cards in your deck, you're always going to be like, but if this was this. If anything, that is a testament to how powerful this card is, that we are like, oh, you know what? There's a decent argument as to what is better, turn one Soul Ring or Demonic Tutor at any point.
Yep, that's a pretty powerful effect. So keep that in mind when you're having your power level discussions and building your decks. Okay, it's time for the deck tech portion of the show. Today we are looking at Knight of Bawa's deck. He's one of our patrons. And if you want to see your deck on the show, you can also hop on over to the Patreon. The link is in the description below. We have perks and tiers and all sorts of stuff. Just head on over and take a look at it. Today we are looking at Skithrix the Blight Dragon, affectionately known as Skittles. Legendary creature dragon skeleton, 4/4 flyer with infect. 1 black, it gains haste. 2 black, it regenerates. That's the card.
Yeah. It will eliminate players very quickly. It is hard to deal with. I mean, yeah, between regeneration and it just being in the command zone, there's a lot of inevitability there.
Yeah, it seems like this card is never going away.
Mm-hmm. Our connection here is that this is a mono black deck. And if you noticed, all 5 cards in the top 5 were black cards.
And our honorable mentions were not.
No. We already knew what direction this deck was going to take. It's infect. It's poison. So what options do we have in mono black?
Well, you have the same card that you have access to in every infect deck. You have Blightsteel Colossus, the colorless 11/11 trample, mm-hmm. Just instantly killing a person.
Mm-hmm. Now, 12 damage is a little hefty, though, for decks that can't cheat it in some way. But
12 mana is also a little hefty for it.
Wait, what did I say?
Damage.
Oh, yeah, that's what I meant. 12 mana is tough. I don't know. That's not a lot of creatures at all. So you're really relying heavily on Skithrix to do the dirty work.
Yeah, you do have to be a little worried, I guess, about Skithrix getting locked down. Right.
Yes.
Regeneration doesn't save him from that. If he gets oubliettes or something, then you need to find another way to win. And it doesn't look like there are going to be that many.
Yeah. Well, let's see what less creatures usually more means more interaction. So,
well, this is a who's who of black commander cards, isn't it? We've got Demonic Tutor, like we talked about, Feed the Swarm, just all the good black interaction, Torment of Hailfire, and Toxic Deluge as classic black effects. Deluge to control the board, Hailfire to kill your opponents without infect.
We see some other tutors that didn't make the list. You see Diabolic Tutor, which is just less efficient Demonic Tutor. I think this is a pretty fair card. I think 4 mana to be able to pull anything that you want out of your deck, reasonable. You probably can't play that the same turn, or if you can, the card is not the most powerful.
Any reason to run this over like Mastermind's Acquisition?
No, you play it for the nostalgia factor.
Okay.
And then Profane Tutor, which I really like. It's Demonic Tutor, but suspended.
I immediately want to cascade into this.
Yeah. I think when it is played as intended, this is also a very fair tutor because you're only paying the two mana for it, but it's very telegraphed. Players have time to figure out what to do before you get the card of your choice.
Yeah, now I'm wondering if there's a way to like play with this with time counters from the Doctor Who set, and there's got to be some way to do it, and it will be bad, but I will enjoy it.
Or just alternate ways to put poison counters on players. So that helps to ease my worries a little bit for like the low creature count.
Always difficult to get the first poison counter on someone, but once you do, we probably can grind out a win.
The Haunting Voyage, I am a little torn on this card because with the low creature count, it is vital to be able to get back what you can, but I would be worried that I wouldn't have enough targets for this often.
Yeah, I mean, the most important creature in the deck is your commander. You're never going to be getting that. Well, maybe sometimes you do let it go to the graveyard knowing that you have this in hand. Mm-hmm. But that's a risky thing to do because if Voyage gets countered or something, your commander's gone for good.
Instant count makes me happy. Great Dark Ritual.
That does look great. And it's a nice price, too.
Specific hate pieces here, and I'm curious about Knight of Bawa's meta, because we have two ways to exile graveyards, or like big chunks of graveyard.
Yeah, I'm always a little interested in these kind of like meta calls, because when I play Commander, it's usually on the show, and it's, you know, controlled deck lists, or it's at a con, and we're playing against literal everyone and everything, so you can't be super aggressive against one particular strategy. Mm-hmm. And I feel like even if I was in a local meta, I wouldn't tech against the other decks, because that just seems kind of lame to me. But
I disagree with, yeah. Because if I'm playing a core group of people, I am absolutely teching against them because I want that like constant like adaptation of decks. Like with me and a very close group of friends, it was constant like, oh, all right, if you're doing the graveyard strategy, like Bajuka Bog in, you know, this Tormod's Crypt in. And then so they have to figure out now, all right, how do I play either against that, or how do I, you know, add some other ways to win to this deck? Because if everybody's teching against everybody, then that's even.
Yeah, I guess to me that's a big if. I feel like a lot of people in their local metas just buy a deck, and it's expensive to upgrade the cards in it and change strategies completely to adapt to someone else who is adapting to you. So maybe you're right, maybe this is fine in Knight of Bawa's particular meta, but I would be worried about taking this to an LGS.
Outside of the very, you know, typical strong black like targeted removal, there are some very fun includes here that I like, and I tend to play these in my black decks. One is Sudden Spoiling. This card is great because it answers a lot of problems that nothing else can answer.
Yeah, it's like dressed down on an instant.
Mm-hmm. That can't be countered.
Yeah.
That can't be responded to at all to solve problems that are coming at you. It can be used to remove like some blockers to get in with Skithrix for, you know, the lethal infect.
Yeah, it's Commander. Everyone is running a creature with a very good ability, unless you're Veggie.
Yes. The other thing that I think is super fun is Imp's Mischief. Also, do not see this played enough. Black interacting on stack.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about this. Sell me on it.
Sometimes if a color doesn't have access to certain effects, even the bad ones are worth running, because like I know you've mentioned before, like I was not expecting like the colorless deck to counter me.
Yeah,
you're not expecting the black deck to be able to redirect your spell. And so
so you're selling me on it is saying, hey, you know this other thing that you hated?
Yes,
this is just like that,
you know. But the other thing that got you.
Yeah,
so like I'm selling this on like play if you're the person playing it, it's great. And that is that does it scales well, because the biggest things that you want to redirect are going to hurt you the most.
yeah, okay, I think you've sold me on not this card. It's such a big feels bad to like be playing a deck, be playing a format, not knowing it super well, but knowing Magic and reasoning about what the opponents can have, then choosing your time to go off, and then, oh, here's this thing that violates everything you know about Magic, and now you're screwed.
Well, okay, but I will counter with, isn't that, that's Black's whole thing.
Well, you won't counter, you'll just change my target.
I'll just change your target, yeah. But like, Black has access to everything in some way. It's usually just inefficient or hurts you a lot. So like, this is just another example of that.
Except, I would say, interaction on the stack. Like, how often do you see a Black card that fights back on the stack?
Twice, Imp's Mischief and Sudden Spoiling.
Perfect, great.
We have to point out a noted bad guy, Tainted Strike. I am not as concerned about this here, because Infect does not stack, and all of your creatures already have Infect.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm missing anything here.
Actually, you know what this might do? This might allow one of your opponents to kill someone else at the table with poison.
Pretty heavy on artifacts, and I think this is the first spot where this pretty drastically veers from your typical like Scytherix or Infect deck. Like, you are going to see like, okay, Lash Writhe, Nightmare Lash, things that you're only running in mono black and are very good to put on Scytherix, but look at all these swords.
I guess that's one of the perks of playing a monocolor deck. Like, you do just get to play a ton of the swords.
My guess is this is more of a flavor choice, because I think the only one that really like synergizes is Truth and Justice because of the proliferate. But a lot of these, like, I don't know, swords are cool. They're a little inefficient, I think, in this day and age, but they're cool. That's it.
I guess flavor-wise, it's like the Phyrexians have corrupted all of the colors, and they've won, and now everything is on their side.
Yeah. What else have we got here? Yeah, look, even more graveyard hate. Tormod's Crypt. Someone has lost to Muldrotha too many times.
I feel like this deck is so all in on Scythrix that I would want more protection for it.
Yeah, and I think that is certainly a weak point for mono black.
Yeah, especially because black can't interact on the stack ever.
Right, if somebody were to aim like a removal spell at it, you don't have a way to redirect that to another target.
Right, it would be stupid if you could. Very little ramp as well. See, the one of Mindstone, the one of Soul Ring. I guess you had Dark Ritual earlier.
Well, there's no Arcane Signet in here. That's fascinating, considering I have 5-mana commander.
And you're running tutors, right? So you're always going to have an outlet for that mana.
A lot of the infect creatures in black are small, so you have some things that you might want to be playing earlier in the game, but I don't know. I'm always in support of ramp, probably a little too much.
Leyline of the Void.
No graveyards.
It's for anyone except me.
So somebody in that local meta has done some reanimate shenanigans one too many times. This is a great, cool throwback card. I love this card, and it's really good here. Because 3 life for a counter, usually not a fantastic rate, but when each of those counters is really +4, like, yeah, if your poison is counting as 4 damage, that is pretty good.
Yeah, it's even a little more than that, because it's much harder to heal that away with lifelink or something.
Mm-hmm. All right. Nice, simple land base. It is mono and black. The oil slick, the oil slick swamps, I mean, is slick.
We've committed to the bit, for
yes.
Sure, yeah.
You have Cabal Coffers, Urborg, of course. And even, you know, even better, because you have multiple ways to search for lands, because Tutor.
Yeah. Cavern of Souls is great at making sure that your commander doesn't get countered. I'm a little interested to see that there's no Shizo Death's Storehouse, unless that's the Phyrexian card there.
Ink Moth Nexus.
Oh, that's it, for sure. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, no Shizo in this list. We do have the Rogue's Passage, but I feel like Infect really just wants to get in, make sure their stuff doesn't get blocked and end the game fast.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's about it for the decklist itself. Veggie, what would you change about it, and how does it score?
This is tough for me. I think the people that play Infect really gotta love Infect, because it's got that stigma of, you know, being toxic. It's hard to win with Infect. People overvalue it because it's scary and it has that reputation. You know, unless there are other Infect players in the pod, you have to do all of the damage yourself. And I don't know. It's certainly not my playstyle. I'm not sure what power level it wants to be, because you are running some you're running some high power tutors, and you're running a lot of things that can eliminate players pretty instantaneously.
That sounds like some intestine bug.
Yeah,
it's like Latin for heartburn or something.
Right. You're running a lot of cards that can eliminate a player right away. And so I think I would want this to lean one way or another if I were playing it. This is super high power, or like a couple more of those cute includes, like the unspeakable symbol and stuff that makes me happy. It does feel like this deck is built for a very local meta, and to me that maybe is more of the appeal of it. I like that environment, but I think outside of that environment, I am not really on board with this. Against my friends, 7 out of 10. They're good with it. I'm teching against them. That's the kind of Magic I want to play. But in general, I give this like a 5 out of 10. It's got some fun cards in it, but it is a strategy and a power level like struggle that I am not usually doing.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, I think this is a powerful Infect deck. So if you are the type of player who likes Infect, then this is the deck for you. Skithrix is a great commander. It's resilient. I think if I were one of those players, I would have a problem with how easy it is in modern Magic to deal with this kind of commander, especially when your main means of protection is so expensive and you can't interact on the stack ever. So, you know, if you're dealing with opponents who are doing things like, you know, enchanting the board, you can't deal with that super well. You can maybe be prevented from attacking them. God forbid they run Solemnity, which in your meta, you know, with people teching against each other, I would absolutely run Solemnity against you. But for me, I'm not an Infect player, and usually I love alternate win conditions decks. Like, I love every kind of alternate win condition, except Infect, because for me it commits the cardinal sin of any commander deck, which is that it is boring. It is boring to me to win a game with Infect. The strategy is mostly the same: get a big creature, pump it up, make it unblockable, hit the opponent, and that might win a lot, but I don't really find winning in commander to be that fun. I would much rather win with like a deck that does something cool and puts something in front of me that I've never seen before. And I don't feel like this deck can show me anything I haven't seen before. So it scores pretty low on my scale. I'd say probably a 4.
I'll open up the can of worms very slightly and say, I actually think that Infect is cool. The problem with it being stuff like Tainted Strike and Triumph of the Hordes, these individual cards give it a very bad reputation for, there was nothing I could do about it. You know, this came out of nowhere. And oftentimes it's not, that's like, those are not the ways that the true Infect decks are winning. It's just like, oh, the mono green player slapped a Triumph of the Hordes in their deck, and that was the thing that won them the game. Or, you know, somebody made a 10 power creature and oops, it Tainted Strike somebody out of the game, and it was me. Infect, it's a hard sell here.
Yeah, overall I think this Infect deck is well built if you're the type of player who likes Infect, and my opinion is not, you know, gospel or anything. If you like, it's like Alexander Keats, those who like it a lot, and it'll make those people very happy. Thank you very much to Knight of Bawa for submitting that wonderful deck list. And if you want to see your deck list on the show or have any number of other perks, you can head on over to our Patreon, where you can get access to members only content, access to certain channels in the Discord, being able to vote on future episodes, and much more.
Yeah, the complete package. And of course, you can always support the show by liking the video, subscribing to the channel, and going to vote for all of these polls. all of the information that we get to discuss on the show is coming from you. And so if you disagreed with anything or placements of cards on this list, then fix it and go to the go below and click the link and vote for the polls. That's all that we've got for the episode for today. So we will see you next time on
Commander Countdown.